judge them. So
would you prefer a hairy man or a naked man?
I don't know which I would prefer. I really couldn't say. I mean, because sometimes I'm attracted to a hairy man, sometimes not.
But I have with me in studio, Sarah. Smile, Sarah. Sarah is here, and Sarah is from Real Social Dynamics. RSD is a dating coaching company, and Sarah specializes in helping men approach women. Sarah, thank you for coming in.
Thank you. Thanks for having me. Yeah, very excited.
Good to meet you. I really appreciate it. And so, how did RSD, Real Social Dynamics, come about? How did that come about?
Well, I think it's nearly 18 years, it's nearly 20 years ago when they first started this. And I think it started with two guys and, you know, they just wanted to have more confidence going out and having better luck with approaching women. And that's where it all started from. So it started from a really, you know, two people, and then they merged and started to create this whole community, which is what I love. That's what I was attracted to, this community which brings people up. And, you know, nearly 20 years later, they've developed this global company and community as well.
Really? So it started by two guys who were afraid of women?
Yeah, 100%. And they wanted to decipher how to be better at it. So
really?
It's amazing.
And, and so what's your role in? Are you like a pickup artist?
No, I would say more of a coach. So I actually help, you know, a lot with emotional trauma healing, unlocking that confidence so that you can have better luck going out. Because really what you discover with anything to do with dating is it's all connected to the core. So you have to get in here and figure out, why don't you feel confident? Why can't you go out there and freely have a conversation with anybody? So once you tap into that and you're able to release a lot of what's going on there and understand it, when you go out, suddenly you're a completely different person and you're able to talk and have way more success with dating and just socializing and networking as well.
Did you go to school for this?
I've always been attracted to it. So I've always been attracted to human psychology. So in school, I remember writing like a 15,000 word thesis on fear and anxiety to do with, you know, social interaction. But yeah.
And so you are known now as a dating coach.
Yes, at this stage, yeah.
Really?
RSD.
And so what is it like for you being a lady, a woman, and a man come in to ask a woman, how do you get a date? I mean, isn't that like a poor, pathetic of a male anyway? Do you laugh at that?
You know what? It's so interesting. I didn't know what to expect coming into this field because obviously it's male predominant. So, you know, I think you have to have a particular perspective. Like, you have to really understand them. If you don't, they're not going to listen, right? And I think there is an aspect of, oh, this is a woman, like, you know, how, you know, what if they view me differently? But what I've found is they're actually able to open up more on the emotional side and be more vulnerable so that we can get in there and rewire and understand what's going on, why don't you have the confidence to begin with, and then actually getting them to do it with me overcomes a lot of that anxiety that they have. So that social anxiety of going out, when there's a woman, it's like, you know, a lot of the time, that's what they're most afraid of, going out and speaking to a girl. So they get to do it in person or with me, and they actually feel more comfortable.
So men come in and talk to you about women, and you said they are vulnerable. So these are vulnerable men. Are they?
100%.
And what's a vulnerable man?
So I would say a vulnerable man is someone that doesn't, well, they've lost touch with their inner confidence. Like, they've lost touch with that inner child that had all the confidence.
Right.
That didn't think about, you know, what they should say or how they should present themselves. Like, all of their social conditioning growing up has told them, don't do this, be quiet, like, don't express yourself like that, don't make eye contact. So now you've got to reverse engineer all of that, you know, damage that has happened to them so that they can rediscover their confidence. That's what it is.
Do you respect, do you like vulnerable men? Would you ever date a vulnerable man?
Yes.
Would date a vulnerable man?
Yes, I 100%.
But isn't that like dating a woman? A vulnerable man is a woman, right?
No. So, you know, there's like this in between, okay? So it's like someone that's vulnerable and like playing that victim, like that to me is toxic vulnerability. But if you're somebody who empowers yourself through honesty of your vulnerability, but at the same time, you know, keeping that self-esteem going high and you, or you're purely just being honest, right? So it actually comes across as more powerful. And somebody like a man having more integrity in themselves because they've done the work, they've done the inner work. I find a vulnerable man is somebody who doesn't deal with it. They actually come across as more insecure to a woman or like anyone that they meet. They come across as more insecure because they're trying so hard to hide something. They're trying so hard to cover it up with layers and layers of let's
would
not
you,
deal with
would
it.
Would you marry a vulnerable man, a weak
yes.
man? You would marry a weak man.
Yeah, but I wouldn't marry a weak man. I would marry someone who has power over his emotions and what's happened to him, and he would have confidence. So it wouldn't be like a weak you know, victim, like, you know, it wouldn't be someone like that.
And so what type of things have you heard from men in looking for a date? What are some of the complaints that men have?
One of the big ones is fear of rejection. Like, before they even get there, before they even get the date, before they even go and talk to somebody, they're already in their head imagining the rejection, like setting themselves up that this is going to go wrong. This isn't going to go right. So that's like one of the biggest issues is not even getting to talking to somebody, but the fear, the actual fear that something bad is going to happen. Another massive one is purely, what do you say? Like, what do I say in conversation? Like, that can paralyze you completely, and you get there, and you might be someone that has a lot to say, you know, has all these cool experiences, but you get in front of a girl or anybody, and you just, and your mind just goes blank. So that's another huge issue that happens.
Are women afraid of men as well?
You know, I work with women as well, and yeah, like, in terms of leadership, like, to me, it's that leadership within yourself and having the confidence to express yourself. So what I find, whether it's men or women, it's giving yourself permission to express yourself. That's huge, because if you don't give yourself permission, then you don't feel confident expressing yourself. You'll wait for somebody else to give you permission, and that's where this gap is, because if you wait for somebody to do that, then it's never going to happen. So you have to get that power.
Have you noticed that men who are afraid of women are also afraid of their mothers? They resent their mothers, so they're afraid to stand up to their mothers unless they're angry. And so they become like what they hate. And because they hate their mothers, they also hate women, and that makes them afraid to deal with women.
Sometimes it's their mother, sometimes it's their father, and sometimes it's their experiences they've had previously with women. But I 100% agree that it's to do with our parents. I mean, our parents, you know, they're the first people that we see.
But isn't it true that it's the mother who turned the children away from the father toward her and have the kids thinking that they resent their fathers when they really resent the mother, because the fathers haven't done anything to the kids? The mother and the father had arguments, but that had nothing to do with the kids. And so the mother made the kids think that she's the victim and the father's the bad guy. And they identify with their mothers, and that causes them to be afraid of women.
I think it's too generalized. I think, you know, I've had people that have had the issues with their mom, but it's very, you know, a child will make a decision. So a child could make that decision that you just described there, but they could quite easily make a decision about their dad not being there for them, and so they don't have a role model, and so they go to their mom for that love, and then therefore they don't build up that backbone, you know, that their own like power through having a male role model, right? So they're more wired to their emotions versus having that. So it really depends. It depends on the person.
So a man who is emotional is a woman, right?
No.
Because normal men, real men are not emotional, they're logical.
Oh, where no,
women are emotional.
More emotional, I would say.
I know, you're right. They yeah. are today, but those yeah. men are like their mothers. They're like women, right?
Yeah.
That's not a normal state of being for a man.
Yeah, it's like, I think it's so amazing. So to me, it's like opposite. So, you know, often women are more emotional and then men are more logical.
Right.
And the cool thing about this is, you know, after childhood, surviving that, you know, just getting through it to whatever point you are, as an adult, now it's time to figure out, how do I understand the yeah. other side? So as a logical man, you want to understand emotions and use that not only for yourself, but to be able to be a better communicator.
So a man should help a woman overcome emotion, not cater to her emotions, but to help her to overcome it, because emotions are hell, right?
Yeah. You know, and I wouldn't even say help her. I wouldn't even say help her overcome it, because then you fall into a different type of relationship. So, you know, in terms of you having an intimate relationship, it would be more you want to guide each other, right? You want to be a team and guide each other. But you taking control of your emotions and your communication skills, that's where you're able to guide somebody successfully, whether it be your partner or a friend.
I'm going to be interviewing a pickup artist soon. What's the difference between a pickup artist and what you do, a dating coach?
I mean, I would say, like, this whole industry has shifted so much.
Yeah.
And I find, you know, that I guess the difference would be somebody who concentrates more on technical things, so more of a technical background in if you do X, Y, Z, then you get this result, right? Versus what I do is more connected with understanding your past, understanding what you're hiding from, regaining the power and going out there and using that skill set in order to change what's happening and how they interact with you. So I find the work that I do is always connected to finding confidence.
Real social dynamics. Is it a national organization or worldwide?
Worldwide. Yeah, globally.
And it's been around for 20 years, you say?
Yeah, almost. I think it's like 17 or 18.
That's amazing. Oh, okay.
Yeah,
that's amazing.
Probably correct me on that.
What do you recommend men do to overcome? Let's say that a guy come in and he sees Sarah. And he's like, oh, Sarah, I'm afraid of women. I need a girlfriend. I'm afraid. So what's number one, two, three, a step you recommend that they do to overcome that and develop courage?
So there's a few options. I mean, if it was with me, that I would have a step-by-step of how you get to that point. But I would say, if you're just at home, you haven't ever spoken to someone, find someone, whether that be a mentor, a coach, go out and actually outsource somebody that you can talk to, that can have an objective view of your position, where you're at, what you're struggling with, so they can give you an action plan, right? You need an action plan to get out of that, because at the moment you're consumed with really negative thoughts, limiting beliefs, and you're not going to be able to get anywhere with that. So you need somebody that can guide you through it. And if you're watching content, because there's so much, I mean, we're saturated with so much content. It's like, do this, do that, like go out and say this specific thing. So, you know, what I would recommend if you're someone in that position, make sure when you're consuming that information that you go out and you put it into action. Because I find most people don't do that, and therefore they're not even trying it. They say, I've tried everything, but you haven't actually gone out and given it a shot. Now, if you're someone that suffers from really bad, like social anxiety, that could be impossible trying to go out and do that. Because often we think our limit, you know, is, you know, oh, I can go out and do this and maybe do it once. But then you realize if you have a mentor or somebody coaching you, you can go so much further. And it's that permission based, right? So with this, it's all like you need permission to really express yourself. So I would definitely say get a mentor or do a live program, something like this, and put it into action straight away so you can see results.
Would you recommend men have sex before marriage?
I mean, I would, yeah.
And why?
Well, to understand yourself, like on some level, it's another way to explore yourself on a deeper level, right? Sexual energy is another form of energy like anything else. And I think you learn a lot going through that process.
What do you find out about yourself by having sex before marriage?
Well, you understand what you're comfortable with. You know, what are you comfortable with?
Like, what do you mean? What are you comfortable with?
You know, you know, if you didn't explore that first, you wouldn't know what your limits are, what your boundaries are, what you're comfortable
with. I don't understand. What limits and boundary are you looking for in sex?
So some people are really, I guess, sensitive about it. You know, like they don't like physical touch, for example. That's maybe not their love language, right? there's an amazing book that describes that. You know, you figure out what love language you are.
And well, if you're can't you ask her that during the dating period? Hey, do you want to have some white babies before when we get married? She said, no, I don't like for you to touch me. And then
yeah,
you
that
say,
would be
well,
something
goodbye.
To address.
I've noticed that women are sex dealers and men are sex addicts. And so how, if a man is an addict to sex, he'd be controlled by the woman. Once he has sex with her out of wedlock, she controls him. Is that right?
Whoa, that's a really amazing way to describe it. I wouldn't say it controls, no. Like, to me, it's a balance, it's a transfer, it's this amazing like energy of like, say somebody you know, because, you know, you're more wired biologically as a male to be more wired to desiring sex. Like, you have more testosterone, like, so naturally, you know, you're more drawn to it. But it's not a control thing. You want it to be something, yeah, that actually empowers both of you.
But you notice that women are not really into sex, but they will service the addict. It's like if a drug addict, the dealer would be really nice to the addict, you know, get them the sex. I mean, get them the drugs. And once they got them, then they control them. Now you got to pay for it. And I noticed that men today, especially millennial men, they go and they get the sex from the woman. Now they have to take her on a trip, buy clothes, buy cars, buy hotels, all to be serving some more sex. And sex is not love, is it?
No, that's a really sad outlook. Like, even as you say that, I'm laughing and I'm like, oh gosh, it's like, you know, you don't want to go down that. And I think that's why I love what I do, because it's about understanding that's not how you do it. Like, it's not this transfer of like, I give you this, then I give you a watch.
But that's what's happening today, right?
Well, you know what? I find, again, specific cases and certain people, yeah, 100%.
Yeah.
But no, if you dig a little deeper, you know, really, like, both men and women are trying to understand each other. And I mean, this has been going on for, you know, who knows how long, right? Since the beginning of time.
But they can't understand one another once they have sex. The man loses because his whole mind and everything is controlled.
No, he's empowered. So
in what way?
So if you understand your emotions as a male, if you understand them fully, then you have control. No one can take that from you. Like, no one can take that. No matter whether you have sex or whether you're in a relationship, whether you get married, you know, because it's like no one takes that from you. That's something you have. Like, every single human, that's something we share. It's like, that's our right. That's our self-worth. Like, that's what we're comfortable with, what our boundaries are. So no other individual can take it unless in our minds we give it to them.
I noticed that people who are emotional cannot control themselves. Men or women, and it's abnormal for a man to be emotional, but I noticed that women who are emotional are out of control.
Yeah.
Have you noticed that?
You know what? I'm totally emotional.
And are you?
I'm emotional. And you know what? The beautiful
thing. Why are you so emotional?
Well, it's just like you feel things on this amazing level, like you react or, you know, depending on, I mean, everyone has this, but depending on your hormones and what's going on and you know, whether something triggers you, right? And that's, again, connected to your social conditioning from when you're younger. If something triggers you, it's just like, whoa, you react and you can't even stop that filter.
Right.
But it's actually something you can train. So you can train, whether you're a woman that's very emotional, you can train to have more control over that. Just as you're a man, you can start to unlock and understand how to be more emotional and actually communicate that and release. Because if you suppress your emotions for too long, it just starts to bubble up and it just
right.
comes
but
out.
But emotional women drive men and children crazy. Have you noticed that?
Yeah, you know what? It's almost like the opposite that women are struggling with is getting that control over their emotions so that they can be more confident and have more power, like, you know, in themselves. Like, they need that power so that they can move through and feel confident. Because what I find is the biggest gap, and this is what causes that drama or causes those issues, whether it's in family or relationships, it's like, they don't know how to deal with that. They don't know how to be open about it. So you have to break that and be open about it and go, why am I reacting like this? Why am I getting angry for no reason? Why am I getting angry because, you know, you didn't come home at a certain time? It's like, you've got to unpack that, just like a guy's got to unpack not expressing their emotions.
It seems as though women love being angry, because I've known many cases where the man can come home from work and if he has a smile on his face, she'll get mad about that. Why are you smiling? I've been at home all day with the kids, and now you're smiling, right? Or he could be sleeping, and she's so angry and emotional, she'll wake up. When he wakes up, she's mad about him resting well. Mm. Why did you sleep well? I didn't sleep well last night. Have you noticed that?
Yeah, and you know what? It's not that she's angry about not sleeping well. It's not that she's angry about him having a smile on his face. It's not understanding each other. Like, when they first met, they were probably attracted to this, you know, being like opposite or you know, having these differences between each other. But then if you sweep things under the rug, if you have kids, if you're busy, you're running around, your emotions get put under the carpet and you never deal with them. So what they bubble up as is exactly that. You come home with a smile on your face, I'm instantly going to be angry.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah.
But it's actually a form of communication. And it's really silly because it's not that effective, right? Because instead of directly saying, hey, I want to spend more quality time with you, it's, why were you home late?
That's right. Mad about nothing.
Yeah.
I got to ask you this. I've noticed that women hate men and that they're trying to take over now the government, schools, the homes, everything. And men, so women hate men. Knowing that women hate men, why would a man go to a woman for advice? Because he suffer as if he takes her advice, he would suffer. Why would a man go to a woman for advice?
I mean, that's, again, I think it's just a certain outlook. Like, if you have that perspective, then it becomes real for you. Like, if you believe that women hate you, like, that becomes a reality for you as an individual.
But right? It's known now around the world that, and you can see it happen in this country because women are accusing men, they're falsely accusing them of sexual harassment, he abuse, and all kind of crap because of the hatred that women have toward men. They don't mind lying on men and destroying them. They'll take the men's children away from him. They would kill the man's child or children in the womb because of their hatred for men, of men. Why would a man go to a woman for advice knowing that women hate men? Why would he trust her?
Yeah, I mean, I don't think it's hate. I don't think it's hate. Like, you know, I think understanding what's going on behind that. Like, hate to me is, one, it's such a strong word, right? But, like, there's so much behind that. Like, if someone hated you, it's like, look behind that. Like, how can you look at it from a meta perspective, from an objective perspective, and go, what has that individual been through?
Right.
And is it really because they hate the man, or is it because they're dealing with something that's happened to them and they need to process that so that they can change their perspective and understand that we work together, not against each other? And it's not like, you know, women are here taking over. It's like, you know, we're just discovering and being more involved. And I think this is creating a good balance. And so with situations like isolated situations, like what you're speaking about, you know, in that case, we need to delve more behind psychologically. What's happening? Why is that occurring? What's happening in the specific relationship? To me, it's more education. It's a lack of education of ourselves. We've got to educate ourselves about ourselves. So the more that you understand yourself, the better you're able to communicate and avoid conflict like that.
We're coming to an end here. Let's see. Someone want to know from you, why does she recommend sex before marriage?
Why do I recommend it?
Yeah.
To me, and again, it totally depends on how you as an individual would like to live your life. Like, if you're religious, I totally respect waiting. But to me, my outlook, I think it's a part that is crucial in understanding myself, okay, before. Like, I wouldn't want to get married without fully understanding that sexual energy, what I like, who I connect with, and sexual energy that empowers you. Because through that experience, you realize, okay, what is really bringing me up and what energy is taking from me, you know? And then you understand, like, if you don't do that and then maybe you go into a relationship and then you start having sex, you don't understand, like, is this right? Like, because you think this is the only way. This is the only way. Right. So if you do it before, you get to really explore that for yourself.
Is sex love?
No, I think no. No, it's not. It's not love.
The only purpose for sex is to make a baby, get married, to make children. If you don't want to have children, there's no reason for sex or marriage. Is that right?
No, I would say it's a bond. It's an emotional bond, having sex. You can choose, this is really interesting, you can choose to shut your connection off with somebody and just have sex and just not even be there, like totally blank, no emotion, right? Yeah. And I guess that's more of like this primal level of reproduction, but there's this whole other side to it, and it's this beautiful energetic connection. Like, even just looking at someone and making eye contact, which really lacks in our society a lot, you know, just making eye contact with someone on the street.
Yeah.
If you bring that into your sexual experiences, it heightens it to an entirely new level where it's not so much about just the sex and reproducing. It's like, whoa, you're connecting, and you can really see that person and they can see you. It's like full vulnerability.
I got to ask you this, and then I want you to give out your information.
Uh-huh.
I work with a lot of men, especially millennial men, right? And I had a discussion, a debate, when we had a discussion, and I've noticed that a lot of millennial men are shaving their bodies and the hairs around their private, like a woman would shave. Would you want a man that shaves like a woman?
You know what?
Or do you want a man with hair or a shaved man, a clean man that looked like a woman?
You know what? I've been with both. I've been with both. And I don't really base it off the first appearance. It's more, how does that person make me feel versus exactly what they look like or, you know, where they're from? It's like, how do I feel around that person? That's mainly how I judge them. So being
with
both.
Would you prefer a hairy man or a naked man?
I don't know which I would prefer. I really couldn't say. I mean, because sometimes I'm attracted to a hairy man. Sometimes not. Totally depends.
All right. Let's see. One more question. Do women have, this is from YouTube, do women have a backup plan, A plan, B plan? Let me see. Let me understand.
When it comes to
do women have a backup plan? A plan B man? I don't know. A plan B man.
Oh, a plan B. Oh, I see what you're saying.
What am I saying?
Yeah,
I don't even understand the question.
You're like, what is this? That makes it, we have to decipher that comment. My take on it is, you know, whether there's a specific guy that you're going for, and you know, maybe it's more like, oh, like this chemical love that you have, but you know, it doesn't really add up in terms of merging your lives together. I would say the plan B guy is like the guy that's more stable, that's more grounded, that's more of a, oh, this is my plan B option in a way. That's my take on it.
Let's see here. Plan A boyfriend doesn't work out. Does she have a plan B?
Yeah.
Boyfriend.
Yeah. So it's like, you know, whether, and this is coming from obviously a woman who has abundance. I mean, there's women out there that can't even get the plan A guy, you know? So if you've got A and B, you're doing all right. So, you know, that's like you try it, you give it your best, you put 100% in with whatever that plan A relationship is. And then I guess if that falls through, it's like you have another guy, right? But to me, I think you don't want to structure it like that, because then that you fall into that transfer. You know what we're talking about before? Like, it's like this, you give me this, I get that. Like, I find you don't want to base people like that. And also, actually, one last comment on that. A plan B guy could be, at that specific time, he wasn't right, or you were at a different point in your life, maybe traveling around or doing a specific career, and so that wouldn't logistically work out with you and that person. So you sort of keep in contact, or you put it to the side, and you're with the first option. Now, if that falls through, it's like maybe you reconnect with that plan B guy. Like, that's how I would take it and go, oh, okay, maybe let's explore, see if there's emotions still there.
Who cheat more, men or women?
Oh, I don't know. I don't know. Have we done global statistics on that? No idea. I think equally. I don't know. I find it really depends. It depends on, like, what's happening in the relationship.
Yeah.
You know, what's happening behind the scenes? Because if someone's not feeling acknowledged, they're not feeling loved, they're more likely to then go and cheat, because they're looking for that love. You know, they're looking for that acknowledgement. So I don't know which one would be more. It's an interesting question.
Emma, you're getting so many questions here, but this is my final one for you.
I like it.
Does she agree? This is from YouTube again. Does she agree with the 80-20 rule that 80% of women go for 20% of men?
Mm-hmm.
Are you familiar with that?
Yes, I'm familiar with that. To me,
do you agree with that?
Yeah, to me, it depends where you've come from. Like, what happens? Like, if you're thinking about like somebody who, you know, is really driven, they have particular goals or whatever they're doing, they're going to look for, I guess, a higher quality person. And what I mean by that is like somebody who is equal in terms of where they're going, the ambitions that they have. And so they're going to look for somebody who has those qualities, right? So if you're a woman who's in that position, then you are going to look for a guy that matches that. Because when you bring two people together, it's like you want to grow together. So that makes it, you know, you're probably going more for 20%, because not as many people are in that that demographic. Now, if you're somebody who's not from that, it's like, you know, maybe it's a bigger pool because to you, somebody is of a higher quality because, you know, according to you, where you're at on a personal level, that's what matches in with you. So
amazing.
If you're basing it off higher quality.
Amazing.
Amazing. Amazing. I love that. Amazing.
Last thing, I've noticed that sex, because when I was growing up, it wasn't gross.
Yeah.
But I noticed that sex has become... Are you a millennial?
Yes. I'm on the cusp.
Oh, you are. I noticed that sex is gross now. Women are teaching men to do oral sex on them, and women are teaching... And men are, I guess, having the women do it to them, too.
Yeah.
And I can't imagine putting my mouth on an oral sex, you know, because it's so gross. You know, especially, you know, like, you have all the garbage coming out of the woman, the blood, the dirt, the funk, you know, the baby, everything. Why do women want men to do something that's so gross on them?
Yeah,
and why would men do something that's so nasty and gross?
I mean, when you say it like that, you know, I'm like visualizing that.
Just think about it. That's where all her waste material goes. Sometimes yeah. she has pus. You know, it's just nasty. Why do they call that sex? And I don't understand why men and women are acting that way with sex.
Why do we have sex?
You're, no, but with the mouth thing.
I'm reconsidering right now. Why am I doing this? Why am I doing this?
But look, with the mouth thing, why is that? Why do they go that far with it? It's not sex. It's just nasty. Why? Why?
You need some positive experiences here, Jesse.
I'm telling you.
You know... It's not like that. If you know, that's purely down to your hygiene, right? You keep that education of hygiene and understanding how to do that, so that when you are, you know, doing anything sexual with somebody, it's not like that at all, right? But
just know that it's a waste area. It's like going to a pile of trash and eating out of the trash, because it's a waste material area.
Well, then we should all just stop being sexual.
But what's the purpose of it? If sex is just getting there, doing it the normal way, be done with it. What's the purpose of going to the trash and eating out of the trash?
It creates something different. So this is
what?
It's more your logical. Like, that description is more coming from the logical. Like, if we were to logically, from a scientific view, it's like, it is pretty gross, this, and this is coming from that area. But if you view it from an emotional perspective, doing things like oral sex allow you to connect with your partner on a completely different level, right? And it's more...
I bet it does.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
You're like the trash picker.
Make that eye contact. It's like, but... The way you describe things is fantastic. So you really change it. Like, if you view it like that, naturally you're not going to enjoy that. If you view it from, wow, like, we are connecting and doing something which is, you know, a way to energetically, like, connect together. Like, that's how I view it, and that's just one way of doing it. And there's many ways. You don't even have to have sex. Like, you could just be with each other, even maybe just touching or holding or making that amazing eye contact, and that be as equally as powerful as doing oral sex or something
like
this.
Did God design it that way? Did God make it that way for men and women to put their mouth down there, or did he just give us a private part to use and be done? Did he make it where the mouth should go there?
Yeah, I mean, I'm not religious, but in terms of, like, God, I mean, I have my idea of...
You don't believe in God?
No, I grew up more atheist, but
Oh, you're an atheist?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, you don't look like an atheist. You look so sweet.
Oh, does that mean you're... I look... What does that mean I look like?
Are you an atheist?
I just grew up without the influence. I actually was in Christian groups, like, growing up, so I definitely was, you know, I experienced it and knew what it was like, so I definitely have an understanding. And from that perspective,
so
I would
say...
Now
you don't believe there is a God?
I believe, like, there's a... God in terms of, like, everything around me. And I think for a lot of people, like, in whether it's Christianity or something like that, it's the same. It's like, that's your God, and that's who, you know, you speak to and gives you guidance. And so I think God, like, you know, no matter what, it's like what you feel, right, morally for you.
So what you feel. So
yeah,
God didn't design it where men and women should go down and empty the trash. But... But it's just based on what you feel.
Yeah.
Oh,
100%.
I see.
Yeah, exactly. And you make that, you create that life for you, and you make those choices. And I think it's purely up to, exactly how you feel and what is right for
Where
you.
Where are you from?
I'm from Australia.
Oh, I like your accent.
Thank you.
Yeah, nice. So how can people get in touch with you? What's your website, your contact information?
Yes, so I actually have a special link for anyone that wants to keep up, because I'll be releasing something at the end of July, so it's very, very exciting. If you want to keep up with that, there is an email link that we could even put in here. I'll see if I can get it up. And if you want to follow me on social media, it's RSD Sarah with a double H on Instagram, and then also on YouTube, it's RSD Sarah. So you can follow me on there. And I put weekly content out on these exact topics that we're talking about, whether it's dating or understanding yourself and overcoming exactly what's holding you back in terms of socializing and dating and relationships. And I'll just get this code for you as well, which here it is. Let me grab it. So this one that is just for everyone listening, rsdsarah.com/JLP. And that's so you can keep up, get any of those bonuses and the email updates of what I'll be releasing in a month.
RSD Sarah/JLP.
Yes.
Sarah, thank you for coming in. You're very interesting.
Thank you. Thank you so much for having me on the show. It was
awesome. I enjoyed that.
Me too.
Okay, thank you. Amazing. Let's see here.